for your breath that is in our lungs, God. God, we honor you and we reverence you for being the God that does all things well. And we worship you in spirit and in the truth in this morning. God, we just usher in your presence even more than now than before in the name of Jesus. We worship you, Jesus. Yeah. You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken.
Designed to punish. It was created to kill. It was meant to showcase earthly power on the side of a hill. It was wood and rope. It was hammer and nails. It was degradation, then death. And it never failed. It was chosen to stop the Christ, to erase the message he taught. It was the bitter end of Jesus. At least, that's what they thought. It was intended to defeat, to put down, to make the disciples give up. But instead, it became the symbol of God's love. The icon of death became the icon of true living. What once marked the end is now the mark of the beginning, a mark of forgiveness, of new life, of new birth. What began at Calvary now covers the earth, over cities, over hospitals, through the streets, through homes. The picture of God's sacrifice is our picture of hope, the lasting image of our Savior and salvation's great cost. This is more than a symbol. This is the cross.
I wonder if you know him. Don't try to mislead me. Do you know my king? The Bible says he's a king of the Jews. He's a king of righteousness. He's a king of the ages. He's a king of heaven. He's a king of glory. He's a king of kings, and he is a Lord of lords. Now that's my king. Well, no barriers can hinder him from pouring out his blessing. No means of measure can define his limitless love. No far-seeing telescope can bring into visibility the coastline of his solar supply. Well, he's enduringly strong. He's eternally steadfast. He's immortally graceful. He's imperially powerful. And he's impartially merciful. That's my king. He's God's son. He's a sinner's savior. He's the centerpiece of civilization. He's unparalleled. He's unprecedented. He's preeminent. Well, he's the loftiest idea in literature. He's the fundamental doctrine of true theology. He's the miracle of the age. He's the superlative of everything good. He's the only one able to supply all of our needs simultaneously. He's available for the tempted and the tried. He sympathizes and he saves. He heals the sick. He cleanses the lepers. He forgives sinners. He delivers the captives. He defends the feeble. He blesses the young. He serves the unfortunate. He regards the aged. He rewards the diligent. And he beautifies the meek. Do you know him? Do you know my king? Well, my king is a king of knowledge. He's a wellspring of wisdom. He's a doorway of deliverance. He's a gateway of glory. He's a pathway of peace. He's a roadway of righteousness. He's a highway of holiness. His promise is sure. His light is matchless. His goodness is limitless. His mercy is everlasting. His love never changes. His word is enough. His grace is sufficient. His reign is righteous. His yoke is easy and his burden is light. Do you know him? Well, he's incomprehensible. He's invincible. He's irresistible. I'm coming to tell you, the heavens of heaven cannot contain him, let alone a man explain him. You can't get him out of your mind. You can't outlive him, and you can't live without him. Well, Pharisees couldn't stand him, but they found out they couldn't stop him. Pilate couldn't find any fault in him. The witnesses couldn't get their testimonies to agree. Herod couldn't kill him. Death couldn't handle him, and the grave couldn't hold him. That's my king. He always has been, and he always will be. I'm talking about he had no predecessor, and he'll have no successor. There was nobody before him, and there'll be nobody after him. You can't impeach him, and he's not going to resign. That's my king. Yeah! Do you know him? He's the master of the mighty. He's the captain of the conquerors. He's the head of the heroes. He's the leader of the legislators. He's the overseer of the overcomers. He's the governor of governors. He's the prince of princes. He's the king of kings. And he's the Lord of lords. That's my king. Yeah!
Come on, let's give the Lord some praise this morning. Happy Resurrection Day! He has risen indeed. Yes, he has. Is there anybody grateful for Jesus this morning? Look, you made it. You made it. Well, good morning. As you take your seats, welcome to Easter at the View. And you push through the rain, and push through the weather, and you made it. So come on, let's give God some praise for that. I'm glad you're with us this morning, and The View is a place for you. Well, because The View is a place for
everybody.
Let's remind ourselves of our four discipleship pillars. Can you say knowing? Can you say being? Can you say doing? Kindly say giving. Knowing Christ. Being a fully devoted disciple of Christ. Doing the will of God. And giving of our time, our talent, and our treasures. When we do those four things, we are a church that is
necessary.
A church that is necessary. Our 2024 theme is one, healing, growing, and serving. In 2024, we want to focus on helping you heal your hurts, habits, and hang-ups. We want to help you grow as a fully devoted disciple of Christ. Then we want to put you on mission, say amen, somebody, to serve others. Now, I want to remind you also that this is a perfect time for you to invite a friend to join us for worship by sharing our stream via text or email or via social media. Invite others to join us in our cyber sanctuary at TheView.Church/online. Once there, they can connect with others, access sermon notes, and so much more. Now, while you're at it, it is time for our social media check-in. Yeah. So whip out your phones. And I want you to take your absolute best shot. Smile. And then put hashtag ViewStrong on your social media, on your Instagram, on your Twitter, on your Facebook, on your TikTok. Perhaps you have MySpace, your LinkedIn. Let them know that you are here at The View. Then put the hashtag ViewStrong, hashtag Easter 2024. So hashtag ViewStrong, hashtag Easter 2024. Now, in a moment, we're going to take a little time to greet one another. I say every week that the church should be the friendliest place on earth. It should be friendlier than Disneyland. When they come in, they should feel the warm embrace of gospel-centered disciples of Christ. The Bible says, and they will know that you're my disciples, not by any other way, but the love you show one toward another. And so, here's your assignment. We want you to identify how many people that you we want you to greet them. Ushers, if we will not allow our guests to enter at this time as we greet one another. So you're going to identify how many folks? That you. Now, if they don't want a holy handshake or hug, what are we going to do? That means I love you, but I still need my 6 feet. And so we sing the song, So Easy. Come on, So Easy. Let's greet our neighbor. Come on, to Jesus. So easy.
So easy.
So easy.
So easy.
So easy. Da, 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 da. One more time. The Jesus in me. So easy.
So easy.
So easy.
So easy.
La, da, 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 da. One last time.
So easy.
So easy.
So easy.
So easy. So easy to love. Amen. Amen. We're so glad that you joined us today on Easter Sunday morning. And at this time, we want to give special recognition to our first-time guest. If you are a first-time guest, would you be courageous enough to stand? We want to recognize you, and we have something for you. If you, this is your first time to The View, welcome! Welcome, welcome, welcome! Welcome! Welcome, welcome, welcome! As you take your seats, we're so glad that you joined us this morning. You've received a Connect card. We ask that you would kindly complete this Connect card. You can either fill it out, or on the back, there's a QR code that will hyperlink you, and you can fill it out online. But here is our ask. We'll ask that you join us at the end of service. You will be released just a little early. A member of our First Impressions team will escort you to our Welcome Center. Once there, I will be there to greet you, answer any questions you might have about our church. But here's the two good things that we have. Say two. The first one is we have a gift for you. It's the only way that you can get the gift is you have to come to the Welcome Center. Here's the second one. We have a donut for you. Say amen. So we're so grateful that you joined us today. The View, let's give a warm welcome to all of our first-time guests. Now, we want to help you grow closer to the Lord, and that requires action. And during this season, we invite you to spring into action. Say, spring into action. With us and grow in your faith by studying the word, by serving others in ministry, and by building our faith together by becoming involved in all of our ministry activities. You should have received a blue handout that outlines all of our spring activities. If you did not receive that blue handout, not to worry, our usher greeters will provide them to you as you exit the worship center. On that handout is all of our upcoming spring activities, but it's also a way for you to get connected virtually. So take your phone out, and then scan this QR code, or you can text the VIP Spring to 84576, and that will give you, it is an interactive process. It will provide you with information in real time. And we want you to get connected at The View. Now, tomorrow we launch our Spring Grow Bible Studies. Come on, let's give God praise. So many of you are still looking at me, so I'm going to give us a redo. Aren't you glad we serve a God of a second chance? Tomorrow we launch Spring Grow. Thank you. And this is the perfect time for you to deepen your faith and get to know others. We have a host of studies throughout the week for men, women, couples, seniors, students, and so much more. Now, as you can see, next weekend we have two events coming up. What are they? Well, we have our men's breakfast, and I want to invite all men to join us for our men's breakfast. We're going to have a great time, and it includes free coffee, free bacon, free eggs, and an amazing and impactful word. RSV today and invite a friend. Then we're hosting our second career workshop where you can get help with your resume, networking, interview skills, and so much more. If you're looking to find a job, if you are unemployed or underemployed, if you're seeking to advance your career, if you are looking for a career change, I invite you to join our career exploration activities, and you can RSVP today. Now, you can see that the following weekend, our middle schoolers and high school students have a big weekend planned. On Friday, April 12th, our middle schoolers will have a night of bowling and arcade fun at Round One in Temecula. Come on, let's give God praise for that. So parents, you must register your children, okay? Because we have a chain of custody protocol. If your child is not registered, they cannot participate because we are responsible for them. Say amen, somebody. And so please register your middle schoolers. Then on April 13th, our high school students will head down to San Diego for a beachside day of fun at Belmont Park. Come on, let's give God praise for that. Again, parents, you must register your children, okay, so that we can have proper account for them. Now, we have a lot of spring activities coming up that I don't want you to miss, and you can get more information about all of our upcoming activities, about all of our spring activities at TheView.Church/weekly. Now, as you know, we are in the midst of our Heart and Soul campaign. And this past week, we got the results of our appraisal, projected appraisal, and the appraisal value did not meet our loan value. So that means that we have to restructure our financial plan to ensure that we're able to build. We're not building in phases. Say amen, somebody. It's a one and done. Come on, give God praise to that. We're not the church. Oh, we're going to build and then 20 years later. No. That is not The View. So that just means that we have some additional work to do. But here's the good news. Say, good news. Good news. I serve a God who is still on the throne. And he promised me that he would do exceedingly and abundantly what we could ever ask, think, or imagine. And so I'd like for you to take a quick view at this update from our build design firm, Matlock. Let's take a look.
Good morning, The View Church.
Morning.
We're so glad you're here on this Easter Sunday. We hope you have a blessed Easter. And we're so excited that you're here to celebrate with your church family Christ's resurrection. Amen. I'm Liz Shorts, and this is Phil Steen, and we're part of a greater team at Matlock Design Build that's working on your expansion project, and we're here to update you on the progress. Phil?
Take it away.
Take it away.
And there is a lot going on. Pastor Gregory asked us to just give you a brief update about what's going on, because at this point we don't have the cool kind of design images that we can share, you know, every week or month, because we're in the city entitlements review phase. So we've submitted our designs, all consultants, not just architectural, but so landscape and everyone else. The city does the review and they came back with comments in late February. We're going to respond to those by next week. It was a large list, but we got it all done. And we'll wait for their response on that. Their design reviews will get shorter and shorter after this one. So that is going on. We also are hoping to start, once the city approves that, we can start on the construction documents, which are the kind of how-to documents based on the designs that you've all seen for the different spaces, the expanded sanctuary, children's area, teen area, etc. But one thing that we wanted to update on additionally, not sure if you've heard yet, is the solar strategy on the site. In lieu of doing landscapes, parking lot, which is a requirement, you don't have it now, but there's a city requirement to have a certain amount of parking stalls shaded. In lieu of doing that, we can put solar canopies, which will shade parking stalls and meet the city requirement, but of course we'll also save the church and you money down the road, decades down the road. There's companies that can do this at essentially no cost and by much cheaper energy. It's a very good deal. Actually, one of the bidders is from Congregation Church is there now, but we'll be meeting with him next week. So getting a couple different bids, and that might actually be the first thing to go construction-wise, because the city goes much quicker on their design reviews for that because there's less documents to review. So we're including that in the city reviews from the design side so they can approve that. And then the construction side, depending on, again, on city reviews, will probably go sooner than the general construction for the building. So that's exciting. Let's see here. So we got those things going. The next step, like I said, we submit everything next week, and the city then has 30 days to do their review. And then we see what their next comments are. They do a traffic review in the meantime and some other miscellaneous things we hope to get to bypass a major environmental review, which I think would be important. But pending that, we should have additional city comments back by end of next month that will give us direction on schedule going down the road. So very excited about that. So just wanted to reiterate that. Very grateful to continue to be working with you. I think everything's going to turn out awesome. This is kind of the quiet phase in what Pastor can share. We wanted to give you just a verbal update and send you a happy Easter. So that's what we're doing. Happy Easter to everyone. And thanks again just for letting us be part of your team.
Happy Easter.
Above our regular tithes and offering, which will provide us with the additional liquidity that we need to ensure that we build our children's center, our youth center, expand our seating capacity in our sanctuary, and also add classrooms and other things. And I don't know about you, but I'm declaring that we will. Would you say we will with me?
We will.
We will build to the glory of God. Would you kind of say we will? We will build our youth building so that our middle schooler and high schoolers will have a gathering place. Say, we will.
We will.
We will build a children's building so that our little ones can be trained up in the fear and admonition of the Lord. Can you kindly say, we will.
We will.
And then when it's done, we'll give God praise just like this. Come on, let's give him praise in advance. One of the ways that you can get involved also is through our Pavers campaign. Pavers will be available for where you can memorialize a loved one or a sacred scripture. As I've said, that I will be memorializing my dad. I had the best dad in the world, and I'm excited for the opportunity to honor him in that way. And perhaps you have a loved one that you would like to honor, and you can get more information at TheView.Church in terms of our Pavers campaign. I want to thank you for being here today. In all of this rain, you made it, and you walked in with your umbrellas and whatnot, but you made it. And so I think you should give God praise because you made it. You could have chose to stay home, but you didn't. You could have said, I'll just watch it online, but you didn't. You made it, and I'm abundantly grateful. Today, we're going to talk about redeem. And our scriptural reference will be in Romans chapter 3. We're looking at verses 20 through 25. Redeemed. I don't know about you, but I'm grateful that I've been redeemed. Here is my prayer today. My prayer is that you'll experience God. That you will know how much he loves you. And that he loved you so much that he gave his son Jesus to die for you. Yeah. And my prayer is that no matter what you are dealing with, that in this moment, God's Spirit will remind you that it's his responsibility to take care of you. In fact, the Bible says, what will worrying do? It won't solve a thing. Our worrying, quiet as it's kept, does not change the heart of God. Because the heart of God is not based upon how we worry. It's based upon God's best for us. So my prayer is that God's Spirit will gently nudge you to remind you that he is with you and that he promised that he'll never leave you nor forsake you. Amen. Kind God, thank you for this moment. In Christ's name, amen. Come on, let's appreciate this amazing choir as they come. Thank you. give the Lord some praise. Hallelujah. I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that he is living. No matter what man might say. And then I like the chorus. He lives. Are you glad about it this morning? He lives. And he walks with me. Oh! And he talks with me. Oh! And he tells me that I am his own. Is there anybody grateful that he's alive today? Hallelujah. 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 He lives. Yes, he does. He lives. He lives. He's not dead. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Good morning. Happy Easter. Teaching today, I'm not preaching. And would you appreciate this amazing choir? And where is Pastor Ansi? He's off. I need you in the front, Reverend. Let's appreciate our pastor, worship and arts. We're grateful for him and for his sacrifice. He serves not only here, but he also serves on Saturdays at another church. And he has really helped us to go to the next level, and I believe that we ought to give him a standing ovation. He's worked hard. Amen. Now, team, I don't know if I cannot hear myself or if it's where I'm positioned. Can you all hear me?
Yeah.
All right, that's what's most important. Easter is one of the most important holy days of our faith. It honors the resurrection of Jesus 3 days after his death by crucifixion. The Bible tells us that after his crucifixion, after his death and burial, he rose. Say, he rose.
He rose.
He rose from the grave 3 days later, conquering death and redeeming us from sin. Can I tell you something? We were created so that we could not wallow in the worst of ourselves. In fact, we're not created so that we would be a tool of the enemy. We were created so that we could be redeemed. Say redeemed. More accurately put, we were created so that we could not just be redeemed, but attain redemption. That means, then, if we were created to be redeemed, if we were created to attain redemption, that means that we all have a need to be redeemed, regardless of when we have lived, regardless of who we think we are, and regardless of what we think we have done. From the most evil to the most righteous, we all need redemption. Put away your super Christian paraphernalia. Stop trying to judge people and evaluate their life. You need to work out your own soul salvation. But here's the good news. Say good news. We need to be redeemed. We were designed for redemption. But the good news is that we were in fact created to be redeemed. We were not created to live this way. I want you to take a look at this short video. Now, there are some snippets that you may want to cover your children's ears. I didn't realize we'd have this many children in this service, but take a look at this short video.
My name is Susan O'Brien, and this is my story. I grew up in the Lower East Side of Manhattan. At the time, it was one of the highest crime areas in New York City. It was a tight neighborhood. Everybody knew each other, but there were lots of gangs. There was stabbings, shootings, high drug area. The first drug that I ever did was hash. I met my first husband when I was 15. And at that time, when I had met my husband, I had no idea he had a drug addiction. Didn't know it, and then finally he revealed that to me. So for me, I lived two separate lives. I was the good drug addict's wife who tried to do everything I could to help my husband. But on the other hand, I was part of a group of people that lived fast. I was treated very well. Clothes, jewelry, money, and lots of trips, and which I love to travel. I was married, but because I traveled all over the world, I had many affairs. And this is how much fear drove me. I had multiple abortions, not just one. And then my first husband, Bobby, he got sick, the beginning of the AIDS epidemic, the beginning where they didn't even know what it was at first. He died at home. We had home care and it was horrible. Horrible end of a life. He was 34 years old. He never lived life. Moved to Arizona and started a new life in Arizona, but didn't really know where I was heading in Arizona. I did New Age, I did bisexual group, non-sexual group. I mean, I did drumming circles. I was seeking. In every part of my life that I was having a hard time, there was always a Christian in my life speaking into my life. I get to Colorado. Then I met Carrie. I say that Carrie is a gift from God. Wanted to have children, so I went to the doctors to come to find out that I had infertility issues, which again goes back to the abortions. I started going to church, non-denominational church at the time. And I went to a brunch thing. And of course it was all the women from Steve's church. And these women were so gracious and loving to me. And I used to think, why do they even let me in their house? Because I'm so different. They had something that I wanted, that I saw. They had peace, and I wanted it. Because I had none. The head of women's ministry said to me, we were talking, and I said to her, you know what? God's been chasing me my whole life. She said to me, do you know how much Jesus is in love with you? And that totally pierced my heart, because it wasn't about me loving anybody. It was about he loved me, and he was in love with me. That was such a turning point. So that night we prayed together and I received the gift of salvation. And again, it began the journey of being in love with Jesus and that relationship, living a fast life and then going into life with Jesus. It doesn't compare. Nothing, it's nothing compared to being with Jesus and developing over the years, loving him. And it's a relationship. Everything that the enemy meant for evil, God turned it for good. I mean, there's so many things he's restored. I could go on and on. Someone who was infertile, he gave me two children. My boys have been brought up with the legacy of Jesus as their foundation. And Carrie and I, we've grown in our marriage with God as our center. The churches we've been in have grown us. I do missions. I love missions because he knows I love people and I love to travel, so he's done that. He redeems. He redeems everything. He is a God of hope and he loves us so much that he did give his son for us.
Sin is man's greatest problem. And the end result, without exception, for sin is death. Sin is described in the Bible as transgression of the law of God and rebellion against God in Deuteronomy. Sin had its beginning with Lucifer, not content with his position. He wanted something more. That's why the Bible says, whatever circumstance you find yourself in, to be what? Content. But not content with his position, he desired to be higher than God. And that was his downfall. That was the beginning of sin. He was renamed Satan. He brought sin to the human race in the Garden of Eden, where he tempted Adam and Eve with the same enticement. You will be like God. Genesis 3 describes Adam and Eve's rebellion, their sin against God, and they rebelled against the commands of God. And since that time, we have had a sin problem because sin has passed down through all generations of mankind. And we, as descendants of Adam and Eve, have inherited their sin problem. Romans 5:12, look at what it tells us. That through Adam, sin entered the world, and so death was passed on to all men because the wages of sin is in sin of disobedience. Adam and Eve chose their own way instead of God's way. The result of the sin were many, but one stands out as far worse than any of the others, even worse than physical death, because the sin in our lives, living a lifestyle of sin, will cause us to possibly become eternally separated from a loving God who created us to be an eternal relationship with him. And can I tell you something? We're all in the same predicament. If we not have a relationship with God through his son Jesus, our destination is guaranteed. But here's the good news. Say good news. Because God loves us. Point to yourself and say, that means me. Because God loves us, before he laid the foundation of the world, he provided a solution to redeem, to take back from the enemy what does not belong to him. You don't belong to him. So he formed a plan of redemption. It's at this moment that we now go to our text found in Romans chapter 3. Verses 20 through 25. Now remember, you are my teaching partners. So, because by the works of the law, none of mankind will be justified. That's a critical word. If you're doing a word study, highlight that, underline that. That is an important word. Justified in his sight. For through the law comes what?
Knowledge.
Of what?
Sin.
But now, apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been what? Being witnessed by the law and the prophets, but it is the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all those who believe. For there is no what? There's no distinction. Now here is the passage, verse 23, that I want us to read together. Let's do that. Being justified as a gift by his grace through the redemption which is in Christ Jesus, whom God displayed publicly as a propitiation, a ransom payment in his blood through faith. This was to demonstrate his righteousness, because in God's merciful restraint, he let the sins previously committed go what? May the Lord add a blessing to the reader and the hearers of his word. This is the word of the Lord. This morning, I'd like for you to consider the most important question you'll ever ask. There is no question that you could ever ask that is of equal importance or value than this one. And here it is. How can I be right with God? There is no question more important than this. How can I be right with God? Sadly, somewhere in the world this morning, a person is offering a sacrifice on an altar, hoping to appease their angry God. Somewhere in the world, a person is cutting themselves, hoping by inflicting pain on themselves, they will win the approval of their deity. Somewhere in the world, people are dying or praying toward Mecca, practicing voodoo, engaging in Santeria, and dabbling in the occult, hoping to engage with God. Why? They're seeking and searching. They do what they do because they hope to connect with God, appease God, or to please God, or to pacify God, or to somehow manipulate God into favoring them. Listen, I get it. We all want to stand before God someday and have him declare that we are good with him. And this explains most of the religious activity in the world around us, from killing chickens to bowing to Mecca, from resting on a bed of nails, praying the rosary, from going to Sunday school to saying the Lord's Prayer. We do what we do because we want to be right with God. But how can I be right with God? It's on the screen. How can I be right with God? So the Apostle Paul provides the answer to mankind's greatest dilemma in our text this morning. Now, when you have a moment, I would encourage you to read verses 9 through 19. We don't have time this morning to read it, but I encourage you to read verses 9 through 19 because Paul provides some piercing truth about you and me, what our condition really is. You know, we want to say that we're all that. Yeah, I'm a good Christian, and oh, I just love God. Oh, I love him. I love him with my whole heart and all this whole kind of stuff, right? But Paul is very pointed and direct. I read it this morning as I was praying about 3 this morning, and I was like, ouch. Because no matter how good I think I am, no matter how faithful I believe I am, we all have a sin problem. That's why you don't put your mouth on people, because your struggle is not their struggle. That's why you don't judge anybody. That's why you keep your mouth zipped, because you got your own stuff. Say amen, somebody. We all have a sin problem. And without a miracle, there is no hope for any of us. That's what we find in our text this morning. Our text this morning contains the greatest news you've ever heard. Martin Luther called it the marrow of theology. So we begin with our exegetical journey that parks at verse 20. Look at what it says. Because by the works of the law, none of mankind will be what?
Justified.
In his what?
Sight.
His is God. This is not Jesus. This is God. In his sight. For through the what?
Law.
Comes knowledge of
sin.
So Paul is quoting Psalm 143:2 that declares what the law cannot do. And then follows with an explanation of it can't do this, but it can do that. So first he explains that no one will be declared righteous, justified in God's sight by works of the law. You don't get a gold star by following the rules. And second, the business of God's law is to make known to men their sin and thereby their need for redemption. And the law, Paul said, cannot redeem you. So Paul continues by introducing what the solution is. Look at it in verse 21. But now, apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been what?
Manifested,
being witnessed by the law and the prophets. Now that's good news. That's Paul's good news. What is the good news, Pastor? Let's say it together. What does it say in orange? That's the good news. That's what we need if we're going to have a relationship with God. You cannot engage with God on your own terms. You are the created. I know y'all talking about, Pastor, I thought you was going to talk about the Easter Bunny. No. You are the created, and he is the creator. That's the good news. The righteousness of God. That's what we need if we're going to have a relationship with God. What sinners need but do not have, God has provided in the person of his son Jesus. Look at what Paul says. But now, apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been what? What does Paul mean when he says, apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been manifested? He is simply saying that God has provided a way for sinful man to be made right in God's sight, and that way is without keeping the requirements of the law. Manifested means that God cause this new way, this better way, in fact, the only way, to become clearly visible. Where did he do it, Pastor? At the cross. When did he do it, Pastor? When Jesus died as a sacrificial lamb to take away the sins of the world. I think we owe Jesus some appreciation there. His crucifixion has been manifested. And the good news is that the word manifested is in the perfect tense. And that means that his manifestation over 2,000 years ago is a completed action that has eternal effect. For our biblical scholars, another way to put it is the righteousness of God was manifested because the one on the cross, the God-man Christ Jesus, the one that we call the righteous one, who the prophet Jeremiah declared being witnessed by the law and the prophets, is in fact the righteous branch of the seed of David. Paul discusses the righteousness we need from God through his son, Jesus. So, How many of you want to be right with God? Wave at me. I see some of you don't want to be right with God. But if you want to be right with God, you must possess his righteousness. However, I don't want us to look past two short words at the beginning of this verse. Let's look at it. Look at what it says. What does it say? But now, the difference between heaven and hell hangs on the meaning of these two simple words, but Paul is contrasting verse 12 with verse 21. Look, in verse 20, Paul made it clear that by the works of the law, no flesh will be justified. Say justified. That means declared righteous. That means to be made right in God's sight, because the law comes not to make you right, but to tell you how much of a sinner you are. The law is like a ruler or a straight edge that you place on something to see if it's straight or crooked. Our facilities person, Gary Perkins, when he's hanging up a picture, he uses this little thing. It's supernatural. Because it is on the wall, and he can tell if it is off by a fraction of an inch. The law is like that ruler that you place on something to see if it's straight or crooked. The straight edge of the law was placed on the hearts of falling man, and God's verdict is, you are crooked. They thought that keeping the law was a way to straighten out their heart problem, but Paul says the truth is, the only thing that the law can do is uncover your heart problem. Then he says, but I have a solution for you. God has given you a solution. Come on. I want you to appreciate in advance God's solution. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Look, I'm getting excited. But God had gave me a solution for my sin problem. He could have said, Greg, you deserve whatever you get. Oh, yeah. He could have said that. He could have said, "You whatever you get, that's what you get, because you did it. But is there anybody grateful for the buts in your life? Wait. But he says, instead of you're terrible, I condemn you, you're all of this, he says, my grace is greater than your sin, and my mercy is stronger than your iniquity. Our lives are so polluted by sin that only God can cleanse us. Why do we need a righteousness from God? Simply put, because we have no righteousness of our own. Now, to some people, this is tragic news. They think that because of some inherited goodness that God will accept them. Wrong. Goodness isn't inherited. In fact, what we inherited from our parents is a sin nature that causes us to turn away from God. Look at what the psalmist said. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin my mother conceived me. Thank you, Lord. We were born with an inbred tendency to sin. That's why we're able to lie and nobody has to teach us how to lie. We weren't born righteous. And since there's no righteousness within us, the only kind of righteousness that will save us is a righteousness that comes from outside of ourselves. That's what Paul means when he says a righteousness from God has been revealed. Say revealed. That's the good news. The righteousness we need, God has provided. I think we ought to give God praise for that. However, this can only be received by faith. Your mama can't impute her righteousness to you. You have to know God for yourself. Not only does the righteousness of God come apart from the law, it is received through faith. Look at verse 22. It is the righteousness of God through what?
Faith.
In who?
Jesus Christ.
For all those who what?
Believe.
Most people say, I trust in God. I got a relationship with the man upstairs. Pardon my use of an urban colloquialism, but you get my point. Salvation depends on more than a vague, pseudo-religious confidence in the man upstairs. Newsflash, faith in God does not save you. Believing that there is a God does not save you. Look at what James 2:19 said. You believe that God is one? He says you do what? But then he says the demons also what? And what else? They know he exists. But that don't mean they saved. The only faith that saves, the only faith that redeems, is faith that is anchored in Christ and Christ alone. When Jesus was preparing his disciples for his arrest and death, the Apostle John recorded these words. Jesus said to him, I am the
way
and the
truth
and the
life.
No one. Comes to the who?
Father.
Except through who?
Me.
I cannot coexist. All pathways do not lead to God. The God that the Islamic folks and the God that the Jewish folks are praying to is not the same God. There is no other name whereby man can be saved. That name is Jesus. Period. It is faith in Jesus that saves. It is faith in Jesus that redeems. Not faith in God alone. God is specific about the prescription for life and living, and he will not accept your substitute. Here's another newsflash. His righteousness is actually for sinners only. So if you super saved, you got it all together, you don't have any issues, you know, you walking and sauntering in the church, I'm brother so-and-so and I'm sister so-and-so. His righteousness is for sinners only. And then, just in case there's confusion on who needs God's righteousness, look at what he declares in verse 23. For all have what?
Sin.
Point to yourself and say, that means me.
That means me.
The church would be better If folks walked around and understood that they are a sinner saved by grace. So rather than strutting around like an ecclesiastical peacock, the Bible says, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And you know, it's interesting, for is a term of explanation, and you're supposed to pause when you're doing a precept study. For four, you're supposed to park, and then you're supposed to reflect on what God is saying. You're supposed to ask yourself, what is the Spirit of God seeking to explain? Four. Well, he's saying there's no difference between the harlot and the debutante. There's no difference between the serial killer and the social worker. There's no difference between the prostitute and the priest. We are all sinners in need of salvation. There's no difference between the morally bankrupt and the pseudo-morally upright. Lost is lost. Paul says that as sinners, we all fall short of the glory of God. What is the glory of God? In theological sense, God's glory is his attributes and character. Where do we see his attributes displayed? We see them in the personhood of his son, Jesus. He lived 33 years, never committed a sin. He never had an evil thought, never had an evil word, never committed an evil deed, never cheated, never lied, never procrastinated, never got bitter, never lost his temper, never lusted, never sought an easy way out of a hard situation, never bent the truth to make himself look good, never cursed, never turned his back on his friend. He lived a perfect, holy life. He was in every way the one perfect person ever to live on earth. But there is no distinction in the word all, because no one can measure up to the life lived by Jesus. And as a result of that, that means we all need Jesus. We all need redemption. Paul continues in verse 24. These words, being justified as a gift by his grace through the redemption which is in Christ Jesus. Verse 23 says, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Christ's redemption has freed us from guilt. How? Because the scripture says, being justified, say justified, as a gift by his grace through the redemption which is in who? Christ Jesus. God sent Jesus on a rescue mission to redeem us. The benefits of redemption include this. Say eternal life. Eternal life. Say forgiveness of sin. Forgiveness. Say adoption into God's family. Say deliverance from sin. Deliverance. Say peace with God. Peace. Say the gift of the Spirit. To be redeemed then is to be forgiven, made holy, justified, freed, adopted, and this is the best one, reconciled back to God. The word redeem means to buy out. The term was used specifically in reference to the purchase of a slave's freedom. If we are redeemed, then our prior condition meant that we were enslaved. God has purchased our freedom, and we are no longer in the bondage of sin, and we're no longer under the restrictions of the law. God has set you free, which is why the Bible says, who the Son has set free is free in. You're not what you say you are. You're a recovering sinner. Verse 24 tells us how God redeems us. By his what? Grace. God saves us. Despite the fact that he can't find a reason within us to save us. God's redemptive work through us and in us is an act of grace. God saves us despite the fact that he can't find a reason within us to save us. There is nothing in us that causes God to want to save us. No good works, no inner beauty, no great moral attainment, no intellectual power. When God saves, he does it despite the fact that we don't deserve it. That's what the grace of God is all about. So here's the big idea. If you get nothing else from our time together, here it is. You ready? Let's put it up. God wants you, but do you want him? I'm not talking about the transactional God that you pray to when you're in a pickle. I'm talking about the God of the Bible. Say amen, somebody. I'm not talking about the God that you pray to when you're at the dealership and you pray and they're going to give you the car. Not that God. I'm not praying. I'm not talking about the God where you are in graduate school and it's 11:59. Lord knows I've been there. And it's 11:59 and you got to hit the button. You remember Pastor Coach. I said, I'm about to hit the button. Pray for me. I'm about to hit the button. And it's 12:02. And you're saying, God, please. And somehow, supernaturally, the canvas system had a bug in it. And you get an email from your professor saying the submittal time has been extended by 15 minutes. Not that God. Are you serving the God of your hurts, habits, and desires and hangups? Or are you truly seeking relationship with God of the Bible? There is a difference. Now we come to our final page, and you can start our gentle music. We find in verse 25. Let's look at that. Look at what it says. Whom God displayed publicly as a propitiation in his blood. Boy, I wish I had more time to unpack this. And then I would say, well, come to the 9:30 service and I have a little more time. But we won't have time there because we have an 11:30 service. So, but let's give God praise anyway, right? But look. Whom God displayed publicly as a propitiation in his blood through faith. This was to demonstrate his what? Because in God's merciful. In God's merciful restraint that says we were so messed up that he could have annihilated us. But because he loved us so much, he restrained himself. He let the sins preach. Y'all still asleep. I'm going to get happy myself. He let the sins previously committed go what? Hey! Wait. I got to finish. And we're almost done. I'm intentionally teaching today. Because who cares if you leave happy if you don't have the word? Paul uses key words in verse 24 and 25. He uses justify. This word comes from the courtrooms of ancient Greece. To justify means declare not guilty. Say not guilty. He uses the word redeem. This word comes from the slave market, right? Remember, to redeem means to be set free. Say set free. Set free because someone has paid the price of setting you free. Then he uses propitiation. Let's say propitiate. This is the literal meaning of the phrase translated sacrifice or atonement. It comes from the sacrificial system of the Old Testament. The word basically means to turn away God's wrath. Christ, our propitiation, means that God's wounded heart due to our sin and God's anger due to our rebellion was satisfied because Jesus, his son, picked up the price. Oh, you should be glad about it. Maybe you didn't get it. Let me be specific. You deserve death. Front, Jerry, please. You deserve death. God gave you life, not because you deserved it, but because of what Jesus did for you. You deserve to be annihilated. But God said, I didn't create you that way. And so I'm going to provide a solution for you. And his name is, front please, Jesus. 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 You want to get right with God? You want to be right with God? You must have a relationship with God. Father, thank you for your word today. You promised it would not return void. Be with us now. In Christ's name, amen. Come on, let's rest to our feet. Would you give the Lord some praise today? I'm going to provide you with three opportunities to respond to our teaching today. First, if you've never accepted Christ, we offer him to you today. Second, if you've accepted Christ, but you would like to make the View Church your home, listen, we're not a perfect church, but we're an amazing church, and I would love to have the sacred privilege of serving as your pastor. And finally, God's house is a house of prayer. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. If you never accepted Christ, we offer him to you today. If you've accepted Christ and you'd like to make the View Church your home, welcome home. And perhaps you just need prayer. Our prayer intercessors and journey partners are here to serve. Is there one? Come on, there's nothing better than knowing Jesus. Come on, he'll pick you up. Come on, you ought to know him. Get to know him. Right now.
Right now.
Come on, there's nothing better.
Nothing better
than knowing Jesus.
Knowing Jesus.
Come on, he'll pick you up.
He'll pick you up. Turn your life around.
Come on, you ought to know him.
You ought to know him.
Get to know him.
Get to know him.
Right now.
Right now.
There's nothing better than knowing Jesus.
Knowing Jesus.
Come on, he'll pick you up.
He will pick you up and turn your life around.
You ought to know him.
You ought to know him.
Get to know him.
Get to know him.
Right now.
Right now. Today just come.
Would you appreciate Minister Christian Morales as he comes?
He is risen, amen? He is risen. And I hope he is risen and alive in your heart. I want to thank you for visiting us. Who here is visiting us for the first time again? Can you please lift up your hand? Thank you, thank you. Welcome, welcome. You are now dismissed if you're a first-time visitor, and you may stop at our Welcome Center. I know it's raining, but we got some gifts for you, so please, when you leave, make sure to stop at the Welcome Center. For everyone else, thank you for coming on Easter Sunday 2024. Amen. He is risen. and for our benediction, let me remind you what it says in the book of Jude. Now to him who is able to protect you from stumbling and to make you stand in the presence of his glory, without blemish and with great joy, without to the only God our Savior through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, power, and authority before all time, now and forever. Amen. We have received the word today. Now it's time for you to spring into action. You have your pamphlets. You know what's coming up soon. So I want to encourage you. Let's spring into action. Amen? Let's pray. Father, we just want to thank you. Thank you for sending your son to die. But we thank you even more that he didn't stay dead. He is now risen. He is alive and living in our hearts and sitting next to your throne, Father. Thank you. I ask you that we just continue to have a great and amazing day, an amazing week, Father, and that this word just be living through every single thing that we do, Father. I bless every single one of my brothers and sisters here, and I ask you that you be with them at all times. In Jesus' precious name we pray, amen. You are dismissed. God bless you.
He bless my sister, he bless wherever this life brings you. Let me encourage you. Let me speak life to you. You can depend
on God
to see you through.
You can depend on me.
To pray for you.
I pray for you.
Pray for me. Have a blessed rest of your day. See you next week. I pray for you, you pray for me.
I pray for you, you pray for me.
And watch God change things. One more time.
I pray for you.
I pray for you, pray for me.
I pray for you, you pray for me.
And watch God change things.
Watch God change things.
One last time, I pray for you, pray for me.
I pray for you, you pray for me. And watch God change things.
I pray for you, you pray for me.
I pray for you.
Let the music play.